Can't think of a better song for us to sing, at least at this point right now in our world, where it seems like everything is kind of going haywire. It seems like everything is kind of up in the air. Talk about how God is great. I think that's a very powerful and good theme that we need at this point in our lives. So I appreciate Nathan for leading that. You would think of all the three people that we have running, and there's a lot happening behind the shows, you would think that I would have the hardest job since I'm the one that's up here actually talking probably more than anybody else. What you don't see is the other two men that are running literally around this church building trying to take care of the audiovisual things. And of course, the worst thing you can do when you're trying to live stream a service is put the preacher in charge of the audio. And so what you heard earlier, that little misstep, that was on me, that was my fault. And that was Nathan trying to hold it together up there while he was also doing about six other things. If you have your Bible, I'd like to open or invite you to open up to James, the first chapter. James chapter 1, I think, is where we're going to be at least for the intro part of this lesson. We talked about a few minutes ago when we led the service off that we're in very uncharted waters. These are times that are basically unprecedented. There have been historical periods throughout time that have kind of mirrored this type of idea. You have epidemics and pandemics and plagues and things like that. But to my knowledge, you don't really have a situation where you have such a monumental type of situation on top of such great technology that can still allow for facilitation and people to still be with each other. And so these are really uncharted waters. And I'm sure the last couple weeks, especially as coronavirus has kind of forced us to lock down inside our homes, the last 2 weeks have either been very hectic for you, they've been running and running and running and trying to recover a whole bunch of different things, or they've been very boring. You may be just in your house and you're just trying to go, you're going stir crazy. So you're driving around aimlessly around your town trying to look for something that you can do while still being away from people. And that's obviously a challenge. But nobody can deny that this time period right now is very unique. And I think you see a little bit of that in James chapter 1. If you look in James chapter 1 starting in verse 2, the way that James kicks off this entire book is more or less with a challenge. That's the way that I like to think about it. In James chapter 1 starting in verse 2, he says, "Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And let endurance have its perfect result, so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing." I love what James has to say there in verses 2 through 4, because he leads off this entire book saying, "Consider it all joy." And you would think when you hear that phrase, you would think, well, what he's talking about in considering all joy is hope, is mercy, is grace, is these types of fantastic things. But he doesn't say that. He says in verses 2 through 4 that you should consider it all joy when you encounter various trials. But the reason for that is given in verses 3 and 4. When he says, "Know that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And endurance, when it has its perfect result, will make you perfect and complete, lacking in nothing." That's a very powerful three-verse set that describes the mindset of a Christian as we go throughout times that test our faith. Now, I'll be the first one to acknowledge that we are not, at this point in time, undergoing a period of persecution. It's not as if the government is coming into church doors and into Christians' homes and dragging them out into the middle of nowhere and persecuting them. That's not what's happening. But nobody can deny that at this point in our life, we are living in a period that really tests our faith. And how your response is through this time period, what your response is to the government, what your response is to reaching out to other Christians, but most importantly, what your response is to God will dictate what your faith is like on the other side. And we can talk about a whole bunch of different things, but keep this in mind, ladies and gentlemen, beyond a shadow of a doubt, we know that Christians' faith, and my faith, your faith, our faith, will look different after the coronavirus than it looks before the coronavirus. And so while it's very easy for us to spend these 2 weeks or possibly even up to 5-6 months or whatever, however long it may be, it may be very easier for us to just kind of hunker down and watch Netflix and read the news and be on Facebook, that mindless, you know, scrolling that we do with our thumbs. It's very easy for us to do stuff like that. What I would challenge all of us to do, and what I would challenge myself to do, is to use this as a time period we can really grow our faith. The first thing that I want us to do as we think about how coronavirus, this time period, can point us to Christ is I want us to get into the Word. You know, I remember when 9/11 happened. I'm not that old. I'm 33 years old. I remember when 9/11 happened. I was a sophomore in high school when that happened. And I remember right after 9/11 when it seemed like not only Olson Park, where I grew up in Amarillo, was slammed, there were so many people. I remember it seemed almost like a spiritual renaissance, where people were coming to churches in droves. They were coming to seek after God. They were looking for religion. They were looking for something higher. And to quote C.S. Lewis, I think he makes a very appropriate point when he says, if we're looking for something beyond this world, we have to look for, or if we have a desire that's outside of this world, we have to look for something outside of this world to satisfy us. And that's what happened after 9/11. And to a certain extent, that's what's happening now, because this virus, nobody seems to understand it. Nobody seems to know where it came from. Nobody seems to know really how to treat it. And there are things that are happening, and I'm not trying to discredit the people that are working very, very hard to overcome this, but it just seems like a big question mark for us. And so when we think about how this coronavirus is affecting our own lives, that unknown forces us to look somewhere else. And I would argue it makes us and it forces us to look upwards towards God. Now, I remember after 9/11, when people were slamming into churches and people were coming to churches in droves, that started to teeter off after a little while. And it was maybe a week, it was maybe 3 weeks, it was maybe a couple months, but that started to regulate. And the people that went to services beforehand pretty much went to services afterwards. But the people that were there, the people that came during that time of crisis, a lot of them just kind of fell by the wayside. And so what I would encourage you to do during this time period of the coronavirus, where it's really threatening us, I would encourage you to dig into the Word. I want you to look in 2 Chronicles chapter 33. The story in 2 Chronicles chapter 33, to me, is one of the most powerful examples of grace. And what we're going to be reading about in 2 Chronicles chapter 33 is a king known as Manasseh. And Manasseh, if you look in 1 and 2 Kings, is not a very reputable character. He's somebody who is very, very evil. But the king's account of Manasseh is very historical. And so what the king's account of Manasseh points to is that Manasseh was wicked, he was evil, he was sinful. But Chronicles takes it a little bit different. 2 Chronicles chapter 33, starting in verse 9, you have the same thing that's mentioned in the book of Kings, where it says, Manasseh misled Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to do more evil than the nations whom the Lord destroyed before the sons of Israel. The Lord, verse 10. So basically, exactly what it says in Kings, you have there in verse 9. Verse 10. The Lord spoke to Manasseh, to his people, but they paid no attention. Therefore, the Lord brought the commanders of the army of the king of Assyria against them. They captured Manasseh with hooks, bound him with bronze chains, and took him to Babylon. And when he was in distress, and if you highlight or underline in your Bible, that's a fantastic phrase. When he was in distress, he entreated the Lord his God and humbled himself greatly before the God of his fathers. And when he prayed to him, he was moved by his entreaty and heard his supplications and brought him again to Jerusalem to his kingdom. Then Manasseh, verse 13, knew that the Lord was God. I want you to notice what happens in this passage. In verse 9, it's a very cursory statement that the Bible makes towards Manasseh's behavior, which is essentially, he could not be more sinful if he tried. And not only is he the one out there engaging in pagan rituals that are not only immoral, but it oftentimes involve genocide, oftentimes involve sexual immorality, basically everything sinful you can do, Manasseh did. And he also led the people into it. But the key phrase there, as he mentions in verse 12, was that when he was in distress, he entreated the Lord his God and humbled himself greatly before the God of his fathers. God heard him in verse 13, and Manasseh knew that the Lord was God. I would argue that a lot of us are doing the same thing right now, as we're undergoing this present distress, this time period where things are just all haywire. It's very easy for us to think God needs to be in charge, or God is in control, God is in charge. The question that I have for you is not just, how are you looking to him now? But how are you going to be looking to him when this is all over? Look at the rest of this story. Verse 14, it says, now after this, after Manasseh came back and God heard his prayer, after Manasseh came back, in verse 14, after this, he built the outer wall of the city of David on the west side of Gihon in the valley, even to the entrance of the fish gate, and he encircled the Ophel with it and made it very high. Then he put army commanders in all the fortified cities of Judah. He also, verse 15, removed the foreign gods and the idol from the house of the Lord, as well as all the altars which he had built in the mountain of the house of the Lord and in Jerusalem, and he threw them outside the city. He set up the altar of the Lord, sacrificed peace offerings and thank offerings on it, and he ordered Judah to serve the Lord God of Israel. Nevertheless, the people still sacrificed, verse 17, in the high places, although only to the Lord their God. What I want you to notice about this section is not only does Manasseh invoke a repentance in his own life, but he invokes a nationwide repentance. And in verse 17, you almost have a callback to the time of Solomon before the temple was built, where people were sacrificing on high places, but they were also sacrificing primarily to God. So this represents a sharp departure from the previous 200, 250 years of history. What Manasseh does in these verses is nothing short of extraordinary. But the key part is, when his distress was over, after he had called on God, when his distress was over, and he comes back to his kingdom, he doesn't just revert back to his old ways. He uses that experience where he was humbled to drive himself closer to God, to evoke lasting change. Ladies and gentlemen, that's what I want you to do. This time period is rough. And there are a lot of things that are happening that we don't understand. There are a lot of things happening that are very dangerous, that are very fearful. But instead of us using this time period to look towards Christ and then go back about our normal lives, I would encourage you to make this time period a time where you can dive into the Word and evoke lasting change within your own life that not only is in for your life, but also towards your family. Schools are canceled indefinitely. And if your family is anything like the families that I know about, including to a certain extent my own, my kids aren't old enough to be in school yet. But schools are canceled indefinitely. Many people's jobs are canceled or kind of postponed, or people are working from home indefinitely. Shops are shutting down. Movie theater in Greenville is shutting down. And so if you're like most families, you kind of find yourself in your house with very, very little to do. And whether or not you're going stir crazy or whether or not you're handling with grace, there's no doubt that this is a very hard time for a lot of us. We're trying to figure out how we can make the most of this time. Here's one idea. Use this time period where you're all just staring at each other, where you're maybe around the dinner table for the first time in months, which you should be. Maybe you're using this time to reconnect with your kids, reconnect with your spouse. Maybe you're using this time to help your family. I would encourage you to make God the focal point of this. God, ladies and gentlemen, should not be taboo in your home. And so if you're in a situation where your kids are home, where you're home with them, use this as an opportunity to really strengthen their faith. Eventually those kids, and I'm learning this firsthand, even though my kids are years away from leaving the house, eventually your kids are going to leave the house. Eventually they're going to have their own jobs. Eventually they're going to go to school, maybe college somewhere. Eventually they're going to leave the house. And the faith that they have when they leave their house or your house will be conditioned and will be established inside your house. And so use this opportunity not as an opportunity to binge watch Netflix, to catch up on all your summer reading, which there's nothing wrong with either of those two things, but carve out time in your everyday life to strengthen and fortify your family towards God. I want you to look at Genesis chapter 18. There's a little nugget here in Genesis chapter 18 of the story of Abraham that I think is very powerful. Genesis chapter 18, starting in verse 16. This is right around the time of the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. But in Genesis chapter 18, starting in verse 16, it says, "The men then arose from there." Those are the people sent from God. It says, "The men arose from there and looked down towards Sodom, and Abraham was walking with them to send them off." And there's quite a bit of difference geographically from where Abraham is to where Sodom and Gomorrah is. And the Lord said, verse 17, "Shall I hide from Abraham what I'm about to do?" Listen to this. "Since Abraham will surely become a great and mighty nation, and in him all the nations of the earth will be blessed. For I have chosen him," verse 19, "so that he may command his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice, so that the Lord may bring upon Abraham what he has spoken about him." Abraham is called the father of many nations. And in that, it's a very literal term. He is literally the father of many nations, whether you're talking about the Ishmaelites or whether you're talking about the Israelites that numbered in the millions. Abraham is literally the father of many nations. But there was a way that the Jews understood this that had very little to do with physical genealogy, had very little to do with who your parents were. And it had everything to do with what they taught you to do. And Genesis chapter 18, what you see here, verses 16 through 19, is God asking himself, "Why should I hide from Abraham what I'm about to do?" Because he needs to know this so that he can transfer it to future generations. And that's the point of God telling him that. God tells him these things. What's going to happen? How to strengthen his family, all the commandments, because he wants Abraham to teach them to his children. When you fast forward to the book of John, for instance, in John chapter 8, you see millennia later, them still kind of holding fast to this idea. And in John the 8th chapter, starting in verse 34, flip over to that. John chapter 8, starting in verse 34. John chapter 8, starting in verse 34. This is in the middle of a huge discussion between Jesus and the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And in John chapter 8, starting in verse 34, Jesus answers them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is the slave of sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever, but the son does remain forever. So if the son makes you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you are Abraham's seeds," verse 37, "yet you seek to kill me because my word has no place in you. I speak the things which I've seen from my father, therefore you also do the things which you've heard from your father." What Jesus is saying in this passage is, look, I'm telling you exactly what Abraham has told you. I'm telling you what I've heard from God. The things that you're hearing in real time, Jesus says, came directly from Jehovah. In verse 19, or verse 39 rather, the people respond back to him. They say, Abraham is our father. Listen to this statement by Jesus, which, by the way, you don't get much more inflammatory in first century Judea than what Jesus says here in verse 39. Jesus said to them, if you are Abraham's children, do the deeds of Abraham. But as it is, you are seeking to kill me, a man who has told you the truth, which I heard from God, this Abraham did not do. You are doing the deeds of your father. They said to him, we were not born of fornication. We have one father, God. Jesus said to them, if God were your father, you would love me. For I proceeded forth and have come from God, for I have not even come on my own initiative, but he sent me, he being God. Why do you not understand what I'm saying? It is because you cannot hear my word. And then Jesus dials it up in verse 44 by saying, you are of your father the devil, and you want to do the desires of your father. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. Whenever he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own nature. For he is a liar, the father of lies. Jesus makes some of the most inflammatory comments that you can make to religious leaders and pretty much make towards anybody in that day and age, and in today's day and age. Because what Jesus communicates to them is that he comes from God. He speaks the word that God has sent him to speak. These people, on the other hand, come from their father, Satan. And these people are beside themselves because they say, how can we come from Satan? Abraham is our father. And in a very literal sense, they're exactly right. Abraham is their literal father, but they don't resemble anything like what Abraham did. Abraham listened to God. Abraham heard God. Abraham communicated God's words to his sons. And so if these people are really sons of God, then they would do what God had told them to do. And we can talk all day long about how we're Christians. And I hope that everybody listening to this is a Christian. But the only mark of a Christian, the true mark of a Christian, whether or not they're obedient towards God. In John chapter 15, really in John chapter 13, pretty much in anywhere in that upper room discourse in John chapter 13 through 16, what Jesus says over and over again, and he makes very emphatic in John chapter 15, is he says, you are my friends if you do what I command you to do. All of us want to be Christians. The question is, are we really doing what God has wanted us to do? Are we listening to what God has said to do in the Bible? Are we obedient to him? And moreover, are we teaching our family to be obedient to him? Use this as an opportunity right now to teach your kids and to teach your family what it means to be a Christian. Fathers, use this as an opportunity to pray with one another. Mothers, use this as an opportunity to model godly behavior and teach through your actions and teach through words what it means to be a Christian. Make God present in your home during this time period. You don't need to keep social distance from him. That was a free joke, by the way. You can also show love towards others. We've talked about how this is an unprecedented time. And to a certain extent, that is true. There's never been a time period, as we mentioned earlier, where technology and pandemics seem to intersect. And so I would argue that for the first time in a lot of places, people are live streaming services all over the country, just like ours. And many people are opening up the Bible app, possibly for the first time. And many people are tuning into other people's services, possibly for the first time. We live in a great time period. But in a lot of ways, what we're going through now has been seen in history. For instance, if you go back to the 4th century and you see Cyprian's plague, which was a pandemic that threatened to annihilate most of the Roman Empire, the church historian Eusebius talks about how there was a difference between the way the pagans handled that and the way the Christians handled that. And the pagans almost were trying to keep as much distance as possible from those who were infected. They were pushing those who were disease-ridden away from them. They were stepping over people who needed their immediate help. Christians, on the other hand, did every single thing they could to help other people. And that, Eusebius says, is the difference between these two groups of people. The Christians, even to a certain extent, at the expense of their own health and their own lives. Now, I need to put a little caveat on there. Most of the people in that day and age were unaware of how germs and diseases were transmitted, even though you can look in the Old Testament, purification laws kind of hint towards that idea. But a lot of people in that day and age were unaware of how germs were transmitted. And so maybe they didn't know in picking up a diseased person that they also probably would contract that. That being said, what you notice within that time period is a cultural difference between the fact that the pagans were in it for themselves, trying to take care of themselves. Christians, on the other hand, were trying to help other people. But I think it's very telling when you look, for instance, in Acts, the 11th chapter, that it mentions that the Christians did not call themselves Christians. Christians were called Christians at Antioch by other people. And when you look at the first 10, 11 chapter of the book of Acts, and you see just the monumental amount of generosity amongst their own ranks, and to a certain extent, even outside those ranks, you cannot get away from the fact that Christians at their core are generous to other people. We need to be people who are generous to others. We need to individually go out and see where we can help. And I'm very happy to say that at Hillside, that's something we've made a priority about. Individuals have gone above and beyond with very little instruction and teaching from anybody else. Christians have gone above and beyond to help other people. And our church is very much flowing in love and consideration and compassion to each other. But we need to keep that going. In John chapter 13, verse 35, another passage there in John, Jesus says, "By this all men will know that you are my disciples. You have love for one another." Obedience is paramount. We can't get away from that. But Jesus says also compassion is important to signal to everybody else that a Christian is truly a Christian. This is the time period where we normally offer an invitation. I'm not going to do that at this point. What I am going to do, though, is pray for us. And if you're one of our members who is listening to this message at your home, I want you to know how much I love you. I hope that you've gotten a lot out of this. I want you to know that the other two men here have done a lot as far as getting the service orchestrated, and we should be indebted to them. But if you're either not a Christian or not a member of Hillside, I would encourage you to reach out. If there are questions, if there are comments that you need us to help you with, or you need anybody to help you with, I would encourage you to do that. And I would encourage you most of all to get into the scripture, to use this time period as an opportunity for us to really dive deep into what God tells us to do, obey him, and serve him. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we're mindful of this opportunity we have to reach out into the world digitally and help one another. We're mindful, Lord, of the fact that we have to keep inside our homes to keep our physical health safe, Lord, but we pray that we would use this as an opportunity to increase our spiritual health. We thank you, Lord, for the advances in technology that make something like this available. We're especially thankful, Lord, for those first responders, the people who are on the front lines who are dealing with this virus day in and day out. We pray that your hand would be upon them. We pray that your hand of healing would be upon them. We pray that your hand of comfort would be on the families of the people of those first responders, of those frontline people. We pray that you would give them comfort, give them peace. We pray, Lord, that you would use us not only in your service to obey you and help us dive into your word and to see what you want us to do in our lives, but also to reach out to our community in any safe way that we can and help one another. We pray, Lord, that you would strengthen us so that our faith on the other side of this will be stronger than it was a few weeks ago. Help us to always walk in your sight. These things I pray.